And somebody said, you guys really had vision at Southwest Airlines. I said, if we'd had vision, we wouldn't have called it Southwest. We would have called it something else. So it was a people thing. Hire attitudes. Teach them the skills. Just what you're doing here. And find the folks that will fit your culture. I've never met anybody that stayed with Southwest Airlines that didn't enjoy it. Because if they didn't enjoy it, they were forced out quickly by their peer group. If they didn't fit the culture. They had 200,000 resumes on file that they had not asked for of people that wanted to work for Southwest Airlines. They could see very clearly what Southwest Airlines is, and they could see, hey, I'm a fit for that. That would be a place that I would like to work. To me, that's how you begin to build a brand. And you've built a brand at Toyota, no doubt about it. And there, whether you've heard that phrase, some fellows in New York wrote, that said, you know, if you sell a product or a service, you'll be known as a vendor or a supplier. If you sell a vision or an experience, and that's what you all do, now you're beginning to develop a brand. He has a line of 20 people wanting to buy beer from him. And he's throwing the peanuts behind his back, and he's opening the beer cans under his leg and talking to the people and signing autographs. So I went down just to watch him, and that was last year, and I did it again this year. He has his own business cards. They're plasticized, and it says 2003 on this one, Mark the Beer Guy. And then you turn it over on the back, and it says height, 6'8", pours right, throws peanuts right-handed, weight 268. And career highlights, worked the World Series, the Stanley Cup Finals, and he's got all the big games that he's worked. I mean, here's a guy selling beer that has developed a brand. So what's the value proposition for Southwest Airlines? That's the little mission statement that we wrote in 1978, 25 years ago. And Herb and I and the 8 or 9 vice presidents went off for a day, and I said, you know, we're not leaving this room until we can write up on the wall in 100 words or less what we're going to be when we grow up. And we figured it out. The key was we weren't an airline. The key for you is you're not a bank. You're an unbank, as somebody said. We aren't an airline. We're in mass transportation. Totally different mentality. And if you're in mass transportation, people are going to perceive you're a cattle car. And if they're going to perceive you're a cattle car, where is the perfume to change that value proposition so people understand? And I'm sure if I ask you what you like least about Southwest Airlines, you would probably say, no seat assignments. I don't like that either. But that is the key to success of Southwest Airlines. And in the early days, when they only had 4 airplanes, they almost ran out of cash. And Lamar Muse, the first president, had the foresight to see, we got to do something really drastic. And he went to the group and said, here's what I want to do. I want to sell 1 airplane to get enough cash to continue to operate. But I want to fly the same number of flights with 3 airplanes as we've been flying with 4. Now, I got another meeting to go to. You all figure out how to do it. And Lamar told me later on, he said, I didn't have a clue how to do it. I just knew we had to do it. And they sat down and they figured out that if you couldn't fly any faster, you couldn't fly any earlier in the morning, you couldn't fly any later at night, the only way you could gain enough time was if you shortened the ground times to 10 minutes, shortened those turnaround times to 10 minutes. Then you could fly the same number of flights with 3 as you did with 4. But if you don't have a superordinate goal that you try to flex ahead, you're never going to get there. So we began to experiment when I got there, is how do you get people to walk on and off airplanes quicker? And we tried putting you in groups of 20, 30, 40, kept experimenting. What we began to learn was if we numbered those boarding passes, you would show up earlier to check in so you could get a lower number, so you could get in the first group of cattle that were going to get on the airplane. And then you would hurry down the jetway so you could get a seat. And we learned if we took out the garment bag racks, you wouldn't stop and hang it up. You would just go wad it up and put it in the overhead bin. That's what we wanted you to do. And then we had one other trick that we tried until the Federal Aviation Agency stopped me. But when the last one of you got on the airplane and we shut the door, we nodded to the guy driving the tug that's going to push the airplane back down below, and he would give the airplane just a little nudge. And it's amazing how quick you'll sit down when you feel that plane starting to go. And then I totally lost my mind and agreed to go across town to Braniff and see if we could save it. It was in gigantic financial trouble. They unfortunately were cooking the books, which we didn't know until we got there. So we had $175 million less in cash than we thought we had. And we only had 10 days of cash, and now I've got 10,000 employees and 100 and some airplanes in 9 countries, and we got 10 days of cash. And I've just left the world's most profitable airline, Southwest, to go with the world's least profitable airline. And I wanted to pick up the phone and call Herb Kelleher back at Southwest and say, hey, Herb, I was just kidding. I really didn't mean to leave. Too late. And we kept it alive for 7 months, and then we finally had to put it into Chapter 11. But we stayed there, and we got it reorganized, and we got it flying again on a much smaller scale. But then we left and went on to other things. But the one point I wanted to make to you is that after we put it into Chapter 11, I really got depressed. I'm a pretty optimistic guy, but I really got down and depressed and feeling sorry for myself. But one morning then, I had my life-changing experience. And I'm following this big truck that had a crane built on it. And I wasn't tailgating, fortunately, when suddenly the guy's drive shaft fell off. And like this 10 or 12 foot missile comes out from under this big truck and it's heading straight for my windshield. So I accelerate and the drive shaft goes right over the top. I came out of my funk real quick. And I'm thinking, man, was I lucky when his transmission housing fell off. And this giant glob of steel came out and I ran over it. And he pulls off to the side of the road because he doesn't have any locomotion. So I pull off behind him, get out, and this guy was the epitome of what you and I know as a good old Texas boy. And he had the overalls on, and the buttons were unbuttoned on the side, and his pant leg was stuffed in the boots. Boots had mud all over him. And he had about a 2-day growth of beard and a chaw on the cheek, and he had an engineer's cap on, kind of sideways. And all he did was walk around this big rig complaining. What a bad day I'm having. This thing was stuck in the mud out at McKinney. I'm going to be late for the next job. The boss is going to be mad. And he goes on and on. I get down and look underneath my car, and it's dripping a little bit of oil, but nothing very serious. So I go over, and I nailed him about on his third revolution about around his truck and stopped him. And I said, sir, why don't you come get in the car with me? We'll go into Louisville. We'll find a phone. We'll call your boss. You can tell him all your troubles. I want to talk to him and see what kind of insurance you got. And we'll get on with our life. So finally he agrees, and he gets in with me. And I'm all dressed up, and I'm driving, and he starts all over again. What a bad day I'm having. This thing was stuck in the mud. I'm going to be late for the next job. I didn't say anything. And finally he looked over at me, and he said, hey, Mac, what do you do for a living? And I said kind of softly, I'm the president of Braniff. He said, damn, thought I was having a bad day.